Where would I be if not for your grace carrying me?
Comes out of John's gospel, and it is found in the 13th chapter, and your verses are 34 and 35. But I just want to back up and read from verse 31 so we can get it in context. We have gone now out, Jesus said, and now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you, this is your scripture, I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. Amen. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. As the Lord, I've come over here this morning to get into your business. That's why I'm here. And I want to ask a question. How is your love life? How is your love life? That's the question. I want to know. Where's the cry? Well, cry's down there. Cry. I want to know how's your love life? Great love life. Over here, I want to know, how's your love life? All right. Over here, how's your love life? All right. Pastor, how's your love life? All right. I just wanted to know how your love life is. Now, while I've chosen to begin this sermon in a light-hearted manner, this is a very serious question. How is your love life? It points to a powerful insight that leaps off the sacred page. How is your love life? Jesus says, as the Common English Bible puts it, but I am giving you a new command. You must love each other just as I have loved you. And so we have gathered in this place this morning to talk about love. That's what we're here for. And if I can anticipate a thought, somebody in here might be saying, hurry up, preacher, and asking Tina Turner's question, what's love got to do with it? We have come here for serious business. God has blessed this congregation for 157 years. And you up there asking about my love life. It's none of your business. But don't turn me off just yet, because I want to argue that love has everything to do with it. See, first of all, some of us ask the question, what's love got to do with it, because we don't understand the true nature and the power of real love. And so in an age when this word love is greatly abused, we need to unpack what the Bible is trying to say to us. Some of us think that love points to those warm and fuzzy feelings that we get when we are waiting for that special someone. Some of us think that love is that sweet sensation when you are anywhere near that special someone. Some of you know what I'm talking about. Please hear me is not that tingly feeling that runs up and down your spine. No, it's not that warm and fuzzy feeling you get when one is with someone you like. See, Jesus is not talking about the feelings we have about our family and our close friends. Listen, listen, listen. There is nothing wrong with romantic love. It has its place. But that is not what Jesus is talking about in this text. No, what Jesus is talking about is not a feeling, but a commitment. It is a commitment to do and to be even when you don't feel like it. When you don't have the feeling. When the feeling is nowhere around. That's what Jesus is talking about. It is to do all you can to help others. Pastor, it's hot in here. I got to come out. I know you're all used to protocol, but everywhere I go, I got to come out of that. I want to look good at first, but then we're going to get ugly in here. See, it is to do all you can to help other people. Yeah. It's to do for people who you don't even like. Yeah. Somebody needs to hear me this morning. Jesus is not talking about warm and fuzzy kind of love. Yeah. He's talking about doing right by everybody, no matter who they might be. This is not about doing unto those who do unto you. Yeah. No, no. This love that Jesus is talking about is about doing for those who you know in your heart are not going to do the same for you. Oh, somebody needs to hear me and come on and walk with me this morning. See, this is not about a feeling. This is about commitment. Committing oneself to do everybody, to do good for everybody, no matter how and who they may be, nor what their social standing might be. It is to treat people right, even though they don't treat you right. Oh, I know. That's hard. That is why Christ's love is so hard, because it is all on us. It is what we are willing to do. What are you willing to give? This is not about giving and expecting something in return. It's about giving or doing and expecting nothing. That is why I come to this house of prayer to raise a question in here. How is your love life? This thing goes even deeper. Jesus is here talking to his disciples. Yeah. The meal we refer to as the Last Supper is over. He has washed his disciples' feet. And he has found that Judas know that he knows what he is about and told him to go on and do your dirty deed. So all of that is done. And he is now talking to those who are left. And Jesus says to the core group, this core group, Jesus says, a new command I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. So you must love one another. Now you must understand that admonishing folk to love one another is not new for Jesus. It may be a new command, but it is certainly not a new teaching. In Matthew 5:43-44, you biblical scholars know that on the summit of the mount, Jesus told the crowd, you have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. See, that telling folk to love other folk is not new for Jesus. No, he's not commanding those who form his group. He is telling those who form his core group to love one another.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Jesus, you see, knew that those who followed after him were going to face all kinds of trouble and problems and woe, that folk would think they were crazy. Do you hear me? To invest their time, their energy, their money, and indeed their lives following this hot shot preacher, this storefront preacher who had concocted this dream that he was the Son of God. Oh, now we look back and we know who he was, but they did not know who he was. He was the local storefront preacher in the community, the one that God, the dignified folks in the church, looked down their noses at. Oh, somebody needs to hear me, because to keep on, when all hell is breaking loose in your life, in the place where you are, you got to love somebody. You see, he understood that when notice that I did, he understood when. Notice that I did not say if. No, I said when the enemy comes against the church. The only thing that will keep them together and keep them going would be their love for one another. You need to hear that. You need to understand that. Not puppy love. Not hound dog love. Not I'm going to love you as long as you love me kind of love. No, I'm talking about real love.
Real love. Yeah.
Love that costs, that does not count the cost.
Yeah.
Love that is unconditional. Love that deals without concern for the other's worth or worthiness. It does not matter who you are. You can be the highest. You can be the banker in the town, but you can also be the man standing on the street corner. They are worthy of our love. I'm talking about a kind of love that accepts people where they are and lifts them to where they ought to be. I'm talking about a love that is forgiving, a love that is redeeming, a love that is reconciling. Oh, I pray that somebody is getting this thing this morning. It's so often that we like to love those folks that love us back. But I'm talking this morning about a love for those folks who don't love you. And we learn how to do this because the Word of God tells us that he loved us first. This text is so pregnant that it's getting ready to pop. Jesus says, a command
I
give you.
Yes.
See, he did not say a commandment. And there is a difference.
Yes.
There is a difference.
Uh-huh.
A commandment is a rule or a law that one should live by or follow, such as the Ten Commandments. And when you don't live by them, you will pay a penalty. But on the other hand, a command is a direct order by someone who has authority over your life. Jesus says, a new command I give you. In other words, you must do this. You don't have any choice. You must love one another. I need to say that clearly. You must love one another. He's not talking about out there. He's talking about in here. He is talking to the church. And somebody needs to hear me. Somebody needs to hear me. Let me use an illustration. Pastor,
yes,
I saw your post
uh-huh.
the other day. And it reminded me of a time when I was a boy. Ooh. I was about 17 years old, starting to feel as the old folks used to say, feel my oats. Yeah. And I almost got out late. I figure this is public domain since it was out there on Facebook.
You can talk about it, Doc.
And my father said he was going to lock his door at 11 o'clock. Now, those were different times. I'm 17 years old, and I got to be in the house at 11 o'clock.
Yeah.
And it was a different time, because there were only two keys. My father had one, and my mother had the other one. See, you didn't have a key to my father's house.
Yeah.
My father said, when you get your key, you will have a mortgage.
Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm 17. I'm a man. You're not gonna tell me. I'm telling up my plans. And I'm gonna try my father. He was not a violent man, but he was a determined man. So I stayed out late, and true to his word, when I got home, the door was locked. No problem. I went around to the back and threw something up at the window and woke my brother up, and he came down and opened the door.
Yeah.
I got in the house, and morning came, and my father looked in there. He didn't get upset. I think he was somewhat relieved that I was in the house and not out in the street. But he had gotten his message across that his door would be locked at 11 o'clock.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm still a man.
That's right.
And hard-headed. And my wife says to me often, why are you so hard-headed? Why were you the hard-headed one? I said, I don't know. I wish I knew. I would not have done half the stuff that I did. But I tried him again. And I came home, and the door was locked again. No problem. I'll go around and wake up my brother, throw something up there. And I woke him up. He stuck his head out the door, and he told me, I ain't opening the door, because Daddy said, if I open the door, then I'm going to be right out there with you. Here's my point. My father's command, it was not a request. It was not something you can do if you want to. No, this is law. If you want to belong in this house, then you got to be in here at 11 o'clock. Somebody ought to be shouting up in here, because Jesus is saying it is a command. You can come by here to Cary and Baker Street every Sunday morning. You can be a tither plus. You can be chairperson of the council or any other leadership position. You can get happy and run around this church selling time. But if you don't love all of the people you run by, then you're doing nothing but getting warm. And you need to hear me. See, that means that person who gets on your last nerve. That person. Who is a pain in your neck. Somebody, I touched on something. That means that person who hurt your feelings years ago. I know church folk who are mad at one another, and when I, pastor, have cried to find out what they're mad about, they don't even know. I have person in one of my churches some years ago who was mean. And she, I acknowledge that. She was a mean sister. And when I got to the church, she was in a position, and I decided, since she's there, I'm going to leave her there. Well, she stirred up so many folks, and every time I turned around, somebody was coming to me, asking me, Reverend, why do you keep Sister, oh, I almost called her name, but good Lord. Let me go back to my paper here. I would tell them that she was there to test our commitment and to test our love. See, we walk around talking about, I love everybody. But then somebody comes and gets in your face and you have forgotten all of that love and you're ready to take them. If she steps outside, we're going to find out about all of this stuff. We had folk in church talking about cutting one another. Now, that does not happen with people who love. And get this. It was that kind of love that pulled the four parents of this congregation together some 157 years ago. This congregation came into being in 1857, which was during the closing days of American slavery. In their secular lives, grown men and grown women were called boys and girls. Life for them was cruel and harsh, but they heard about this Jesus who had talked about love for all people, no matter their station or condition, and they responded. And in Jesus's house, which is now known as Ames Memorial United Methodist Church, they became men and women who were loved and treated with the dignity and respect that they deserve. See, sometimes you need to say to folk,
that's right,
we don't have to like each other, but I'm going to love you anyway. Which means I want the best for you. I'm going to help you in any way I can. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to pray for you because I am under divine orders to love. That's that. See, the head of this house, my daddy's son, who is the head of this house, says that I must love you. That, like my daddy said, you live in this house, you gotta be here at 11 p.m. The head of this house says you got to love each other. It does not matter how they treat you. It does not matter whether they speak to you or put your head up in the air and strut around. You got to love them anyway. See, we need this, my brothers and my sisters. Oh, God, help me to get this right. See, you may have a whole lot of creature comforts. You may drive a fancy car, and you may have a designer wardrobe, and you have lots of disposable income. But if you don't have love in your life, then all that stuff means nothing. If you don't have folk around you who will love you no matter what, love you when you are lovable, love you when you are unlovable, then all of your stuff means nothing. All of us need love. That's what love's got to do with it. Jesus says, I have loved you, so you must love one another. There it is, Ames Church, in a nutshell. It's not complicated. I one another. That's what Jesus says. One is the cause and the other is the effect. This phrase can also be translated, since I have loved you, then you love one another. We love one another because Jesus first loved us. This love commands starts with him. Him, that's who it is, and it flows from him down to us. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. That's why I'm going to bless the Lord at all times. His praise will continually be in my mouth. See, I made up my mind when I left my home over there in West Baltimore, that I was going to praise my God in this place if I had to do it all by myself. If folks sat up in a dignified church and could not lift up a hand and praise the Lord, I'm going to praise him all by myself. Somebody ought to bless his name in this. Somebody ought to say thank you in this place. Can I get just one witness in this place who will give God some praise, who will say glory, hallelujah to his name? Can I get one person who will stand up and bless the Lord? Can I get one person who don't mind for the Lord? Somebody ought to bless his name. Somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to say, glory!
Chains were on your feet.
Right.
I would not leave out of this place right now the same way you came.
Thank you, Lord.
There's no room at the cross just for you.
Yes.
So the doors of the church are open. Is there one? Is there one? Sister, what is your name? Natasha. Natasha. You come in here and confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Are you ready for change? Are you ready for the love of God that can love you like you love another? I see in the spirit that you can fight a long time. I see in the spirit that the struggle has been there a long time. But I come to tell you that the struggle is over for you. Eyes have not seen, neither have ears heard, neither has it entered into the hearts of men, but God has prepared for you. So I come to tell you, you just keep open loud. It might be hard right now, but brighter days are here. The sun is going to shine again. I don't care what the naysayers say, but I tell you, you are more than a conqueror. You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. I love that, and God loves you, and there's work for you to do in the kingdom. My God. Looking good. And I see this is not an easy struggle for you. But God is going to do a good work. Your best days are here and not behind you. God has work for you to do. You confess Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You know what? You can hit your head against the wall so many times until you get tired of hitting your head against the wall. But God is saying, you're not going to just run into the glass. You're going to kick the glass in and shatter the glass. Because what God is about to do to you and to you and through you is going to defy my odds. And you're going to be what people say you could never do. You have to struggle your whole life to get to where you are today. And guess what? You're not going to quit. You're not going to give up. Because what God has for you, it is for you. Give me your full name. Washington, Cheryl, Sherrod, Washington, that's a great name, because you're a great person.
Amen.
And God has greatness, God has greatness in you. And my dear brother, my brother, we met the other day walking down the street. He said, "Would you mind praying among us?" I said, "Why don't you come to church on Sunday and pray?" Not only does he pray among us, but he can sing. Not only can he sing, but he can play the piano. And I said, "Just come and let God bless." He's confessed Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior already. And let me tell you something. The truth of the matter is, he actually joined the church on Thursday. But I told him to come back on Sunday to make a